General Douglas MacArthur exercised extraordinary powers in Japan after the instrument of surrender was executed. This book, by Dr. Dale Smith, directly addresses the issue as to whether MacArthur actually had the lawful power to order the execution of six generals and a civilian, Premier Hirota. It also examines the legal basis for such a trial, allegedly under international law. Judicial murder deals with the government of Japan from several perspectives, historical, cultural, philosophic and legal, up to 2 September 1945 when the instrument of surrender was signed. MacArthur, as commander of the Allied forces, was not a person who was clothed with any of the judicial power of the United States of the America, nor could he exercise any of the judicial power of Japan. If the order he was to give that brought about the execution of the seven condemned prisoners was not an act lawfully authorized, justified or excused by law, then what did his conduct amount to in law? We're talking to Dr. Dale Smith about a book he's written in relation to the Japanese war crimes trials at the end of the Second World War. So, Dale, could you show us the book that you've written?
Yes, that is a book, Judicial Murder, MacArthur and the Tokyo War Crimes Trial. But importantly, it has a question mark after the word murder.
Yeah, why a question mark? Why not just state what you are talking about? Why introduce a question mark into the title?
Because in any question of law involving, or any trial involving questions of law and fact, there is always a determination at some stage of what law governs the proceedings and what are the facts to which the judges must have regard. And I don't know all of the facts and I don't know all of the law, but all that I've read has led me to the conclusion that there are very serious questions about whether MacArthur had the authority to give the order at the end of the trial to have a civilian Prime Minister who did nothing other than serve as Prime Minister, or Premier in fact, to the Emperor of the day, to have him executed as a war criminal after the war was over.
Do you feel that this work, which really talks about an historic event in 1946, 47, 48, do you feel that those developments have any particular relevance to issues that we face today in society?
Well, the critical issue in the law of war that's relevant to this book was laid down some 2,500 years ago by a Greek historian who wrote of the Peloponnesian Wars in Greece by the name of Thucydides. And his pithy summary of what war was about still applies. And what Thucydides said was, right as the world goes is only in question between equals in power. While the strong do what they can and the weak suffer what they must. So there's a very clear difference historically drawn between what a powerful army can do and what's right. And that moral question has plagued people ever since.
Okay.
And it's now called a just war. Is this a just war that we're engaged in this country or in that country?
So a war doesn't equal a war, and you're examining the actual dynamics of this particular conflict.
Yes.
Okay. Can you tell us the key differences between the Nuremberg trials about the Nazi war criminals and the Japanese war crimes trials in Tokyo?
The trials at Nuremberg followed the complete defeat by the Germans by the Allies, and Germany completely surrendered. That's it, nothing, we give up the lot. And the Allies took over, including Russia and America, France and England, took over all of the instruments of government. They were therefore in the same position to prosecute for theft, for murder, for high treason, as was the government of Germany. In Japan, Japan did not ever surrender unconditionally. Japan only ever surrendered on conditions, and those conditions were very carefully haggled about over a fair period of time.
Okay, what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to work out what questions you're asking yourself as the author of this book. And you asked yourself why the differences were important in writing this book. This is one of the things you addressed.
Mm.
Why do you think the differences were important? Why are they significant?
Because Nuremberg has been taken as being a pronouncement of the law because of the quality and nature of the judges and the arguments before it and the sheer stark black and white of the participants who took part, that is, the accused. There were some 28, 29 accused, and they were in Nuremberg,
mm-hmm.
and they were people ranging from the Deputy Chancellor right down through Reichsführer, right down the way to various people involved in concentration camp. I won't use the word work, but in concentration camp experiments. Now, those people belonged to a different sense, to a different group of people than the ordinary soldiers of Japan.
Okay. Now, what was...
They also represented the leadership of Germany. They represented the combined effect of several years' election, although it must be stated that Hitler never got more than 38% in a free election.
Okay. Can you briefly describe what was construed in legal terms as a war crime after World War One?
World War One gave the victors at Versailles, that's where the treaty was haggled about. Curiously, the war stopped, and then they argued about the terms of the treaty. And there were two schools of thought predominantly. One school of thought said that you can't hold an eminent person like a king or a kaiser or a queen or someone like that responsible for a crime that might have been done by a lackey or a corporal or a sergeant or whatever. And the other school held the view that if a king gave an order and that order was carried out by a sergeant or a corporal and that was illegal, then the king should be liable. Now, that took a lot of haggling. If you go through the papers, you'll find it went on for a long time.
And that was one of the conclusions that were drawn out of the Nuremberg events, yes?
No. What they drew out of the Versailles conference was two things. There was the first principle, which was governed by the majority, which was a king's not responsible, he didn't do the murdering, or the sergeant didn't do it. The person who's responsible is the sergeant himself if he commits a war crime in the strict sense. Now, there were two countries that rejected that argument. One was America, and America said, you can't do that. You can't subject a head of state like the commander-in-chief of the United States Army, which is the president, of course. You can't subject him to the laws of a foreign country. That would be to make him liable to someone other than American electors. So therefore, you cannot possibly have a war crime committed by an American soldier, in effect.
Right. That's pretty crucial to the way you explore this whole issue, I would think. Okay, so
One other country also took that view, and that was Japan. Because in Japan, if the emperor gave an order, then unless the emperor himself recalled the order, it was a bit like the laws of the Medes and the Persians. The order stayed. So if he gave the order to advance, you advanced, and everybody advanced together.
You dealt before with how the war in Germany ended. Why do you think it's significant that the war in Japan ended in a different way? You say it did, and could you please outline that for us? And why do you think it's significant?
Well, three reasons. One, Japan had never in its history lost a war. A unique feature among countries in the world in the mid-19th century, 20th century. Two, Japan had therefore no idea on how to go about ending a war from the point of view of being a defeated country. It had certainly beaten other countries. It had beaten Russia twice, and it had beaten the Chinese several times, But this was the first time that Japan itself was beaten, and they had no plan B. They therefore did not know what to do, and all they could think of was to save the finest piece of crockery out of the collection. So they clung to the emperor, and they clung to the emperor system called the Tenno system. The emperor was the god, he was the father of all the Japanese, and he was chief of the armed forces. And if he gave an order, it didn't matter whether it was silly or otherwise, you followed it. For example, in his rescript on education, his grandfather said, these are the things that you must do. And photographs came out in the 1890s, and photographs of the emperor appeared on the walls in the schools. So if the school got on fire, the school teacher had to rush in and stop the emperor's image from burning. And the emperor had to then issue another rescript saying, hey, hang on, it's not that important. It's only a picture.
Please save yourselves.
It's more important that we have children who are taught. Now, when it comes to how to end this war, the Japanese insisted on the cutlery. They wanted to keep the prize, which was the Tenno system, which is what made, to them, Japan unique. Every country believes they're unique in the world, but other people have different views. Japan believed they were unique because they had the Tenno system. Now, that system meant that the mere thought of getting rid of Japan would have, as Macarthur himself said, required an extra million troops in Japan. And that was not to be countenanced, because at this time there looked like being a long-going war in Europe between the West and Russia, and America had no resources to spend. So they wanted the occupation to be short. They therefore gave instructions to hammer out an instrument of surrender. The Americans fondly referred to it as an unconditional surrender. The Japanese, to whom words were very important, said a surrender on conditions is not an unconditional surrender, by definition. So the first critical argument before the tribunal, which had been set up by Macarthur, not by any of the countries involved, although they had notional representatives, been set up by Macarthur, the first question was, does this tribunal, international military tribunal, nice big words, does it have any real power to make decisions as a court of law? Because it is not a court of law. And the constitution of the tribunal, which is contained in the book, and all the rules of evidence, which, you know, trample on hundreds of years of evidence principles in English law, laid out how the tribunal was to function. And it was never to have any power. It could never do anything other than make a recommendation. And to whom could it make a recommendation to? General Douglas Macarthur.
Could you just please run through the matters that you deal with in this work of yours, section by section?
I'll start by saying what issues I do not deal with. I don't deal with questions of the rightness or the wrongness of the going to war. I don't deal with the rightness or wrongness of the questions of how Japan was conducted internally. I don't go to morality questions about whether America was right in what it did or wrong, or whether Japan was right or wrong. These are open questions. That's why the question mark in the title. But there are many things that are capable of being put into reasonably straightforward terms, and I've raised them as matters to be studied. The first clear one is treaties, declarations and documents. There was, between Versailles and World War II, a big attempt to try to get a new treaty in which worked out how wars ended. Chapter 3, structure and organisation of the trial, assumptions about the trial. Chapter 4 dealt with the notion of conspiracy. Remember, the Japanese had no concept of what a conspiracy was. To them, it just meant co-breathing. And the substantive issues of law come in the jurisdiction. and there are several challenges to the jurisdiction, something like 12 of them, and they are dealt with in Chapter 5. And then in order to understand the background from which the person around whom the book was written mostly, Koki Hirota, who was Prime Minister, the first civilian of Prime Minister of Japan, I deal with traditional Japan, how the rules of Japanese society are so different from the rest of Asia, then the less than wholly diplomatic way in which America knocked on the door of Japan with Commodore Perry and his black ships, and Japan's response by, and it's called Meiji Japan, the emperor's name was not Meiji, but the period is known as Meiji, then influences behind the Meiji Japan, that is, Japan had always been governed by an emperor in theory, but the shogun governed behind the scenes. The emperor lived in Kyoto, the shogun lived in, relatively speaking, modern times in Tokyo or Edo. Now, the influences on Meiji Japan, which is, of course, the time when Japan was being forced to come out of its period of quietude and enter the modern world, then the Meiji Constitution in action. So they had to draw up a constitution in a country where the Attorney General equivalent had to write to the judges saying, look, it's not right that you can order beatings of plaintiffs. That's not the job of the court. The court is to decide on the merits of a competing dispute. So you've got very different views. The emperor declares war. The process by which the emperor declared war is so opaque that you can read it several times and be none the wiser. But in short, it meant that the emperor had a conference of all of his chief advisers, all present in the room, and the emperor sat there absolutely mute from beginning to end. So although he knew, in the sense that people were telling him what he was thinking, he himself had no say in what was going on. And then the emperor questioned, what was the emperor question? That is, what was his liability for the war? The supreme command in action, which deals with the results of the English Civil War in 1688 and the earlier war between Parliament, and how that had set up a system of law which most of the British colonies took into effect. And then I deal with the supreme command in America, which of course went a different route. The Americans believed that the supreme commander was literally just about God. And the first one, unsurprisingly, turns up to deal with Abraham Lincoln. That's the first time the issue was really raised. Chapter 13 deals with the supreme commander, of which, who was Macarthur, General Douglas Macarthur, the man who rehearsed his landings on Manila. And then there were different kinds of power that he had. And I defined, because there is no real clear terms to define this, so I divided it up into real power and coercive power. Real power is a power to say to sergeant, take this prisoner out tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock and shoot him. Coercive power is power to say to someone else, would you mind doing this, taking this prisoner out and, if you like, shooting? Now, those two had to operate together because you've got a general like Macarthur giving orders that he expects to be obeyed, and the court giving a recommendation which it normally expects to be followed. And then the exercise of raw power and legitimate power in Japan is contrasted and conclusions to be drawn from that. And the book also contains very important public documents, the General Treaty for the Renunciation of War and each of the other treaties that led up to the proclamation of the IMTFE, which is the Tokyo War Crimes Trial. It's important to remember when discussing this that this is not like Nuremberg. Was not. It is not a trial of all of those from Japanese extraction who were accused of war crimes. Australia held hundreds and hundreds of war crimes trials in the Pacific. We had the highest acquittal rate. American had dealt with many more because they had thousands more circumstances, and they held military trials they were held under military law, and they were held in the Pacific, and they executed lots of people, and they acquitted other people. What's unique about the IMTFE is that it acquitted no one. The only person who got out was
IMTFE
a person...
IMTFE is the Tokyo...
Tokyo War Crimes Trial, yes. Mm. The only person who was acquitted was a person who pretended he was mad. And on the first day of the trial, he was sitting behind Tojo, and he got up and hit Tojo over the head with a sheaf of papers and said, "Tojo and I are brothers." And in fact, he died in about 1970s in a brothel. So he lived to a fairly old age. Otherwise, every single person who was indicted was charged, even to the extent where they had too many indictees, so they had to get rid of two to add in two more Russian people they wanted to charge, and because the dock was only built to hold so many people.
So what you're saying then is that if someone's interested in the whole question of war and the legitimacy of war or lack thereof, that quite a lot of the source material connected with those discussions is in the back of your book as addenda, as appendix, is that right?
Yes, but a lot of it's also in the book itself, because the book was written before the trials arising out of Guantanamo Bay had been concluded.
Mm.
And it was written before David Hicks had pleaded guilty. So the tests which I lay out are no different from those laid out over the legitimacy of the Vietnam War. And you judge the legitimacy of the war by what it sets out to achieve and what it does achieve. And was it a just war? Was it not a just war?